Let's all stand together, please. Good morning, everyone.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior.
Help me to rid my Morning, Calvary. I'm going to be reading from John chapter 1, verse 14. It says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." And then I have some announcements for this morning. This week, I believe it's this week, the Women's Book Club is going through Jonah. It's navigating through life's interruptions. And it's the first Monday night of every month. And then there's a change of date for that. It's on December 10th. So that's in your bulletin. And then this week we've also had the youth went ice skating yesterday. So it was really great. They had a good time. Nobody fell or anything. It was good times. Nobody got hurt. So have a great rest of your morning.
Let's all please stand together. We're going to start singing a few Christmas songs each week as we prepare for the seasons. Let's stand as we sing, "O Come All Ye Faithful."
O come all ye faithful, joyful and joyful. O come ye, O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord. Sing choirs of angels, sing in exaltation. Oh, sing all ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God.
Moments and greet each other. Thank you. please stand together? We're going to sing this song, I Cannot Tell.
I cannot tell why he whom angels worship should set his love upon the sons of men, or why as shepherds he should seek the wanderers to bring them back, they know not how or when. But this I know, that he was born of Mary, when Bethlehem manger was his only home, and that he lived at Nazareth and labored, and so the Savior, Savior of the world is come.
Sing verse number 4.
I cannot tell how all the land shall worship when at his biding every storm is still, or who can say how great the jubilation when all the hearts of men with love are filled. But this I know, the skies will thrill with rapture and countless noise
Before I lead us in prayer and we receive the morning offering, I'd like to just call your attention to the fact that in the back of the sanctuary, in the foyer, we have copies of the family prayer journal, and this is an encouragement to all of us to pray for each other. And it's a powerful thing when God's people hold each other up in prayer throughout the week. It is a profound gift to each other. You'll notice if you look at our prayer journal, it has we always have a devotional piece. This is usually done by Pastor Dennis, and we're very thankful for that. We've got, if you also will notice, birthdays and anniversaries are on here. If you have already picked yours up, you'll have already noticed that Gail Thompson's birthday is today. Isn't that nice? And sorry, Gail, I only gave you one clap. I guess no disrespect there. We're about the same age, so I may have just hurt her feelings. You'll also notice on the back of the prayer journal that it says Missionary Christmas Card Shower. And we've got the addresses of all of our missionaries here, encouraging you to send them a Christmas card. Also, this is a reminder to us that next Sunday we'll be receiving a special offering. It's a Christmas offering to our missionaries, and we want you to plan for that. You may have already come prepared to do so. We did announce this last week as well. So, but we want to make sure that we give just a wonderful gift. We divide this equally among all of our missionaries, and Calvary has blessed our missionaries every year, and they're very, very thankful for this special gift. I also want you to know, that when this was prepared on Friday, we hadn't heard yet, but Terry Ortner's mother passed away on Friday, and Terry's already back in Minnesota for service for her mother. And so we want to lift Terry and her family up to the Lord. Let me lead us in prayer right now, and then we'll ask the ushers to come forward and receive the offering. Father, I thank you so much for the opportunity to encourage each other and pray for each other. We pray, Lord, that we would remember anytime someone comes to our mind, whoever that would be, that we would pray for them. And we pray that you would teach us to pray. We thank you, Father, for our missionaries, and pray, Lord, that you'd stir our hearts to give them really an encouraging Christmas gift. And we thank you, Lord, for the way Calvary has loved and supported many, many missionaries over the years. Thanks, Father, that we can sing these wonderful songs at this time of year. And while they can easily pass off as being routine, I pray that you would engage our minds and our hearts as we remember the one who poured himself out of heaven to take on flesh for us. This morning, Father, I pray for Terry and for her family at the loss of her mother. I thank you, Father, for the years that you gave them with their mom. And I pray, Lord, that you would comfort them, give them peace and encouragement. And even as they gather to remember her, I pray that their hearts would be blessed with all sorts of wonderful memories. Thanks, Lord, for Gail and for her birthday today and for the tremendous encouragement she is to me and to our church and the way she serves so very faithfully and loves you and actively trusts you. Bless her today. And now, Lord, we give our tithes and offerings to you, and we ask that you would use these gifts to honor the Lord Jesus. I pray this in his name. Amen.
morning. My name is Marilyn Plug, and I'll be teaching Children's Church today. I want to remind the parents that December 15th on Saturday, we'll be having our Children's Christmas Party upstairs in our Children's Church room from 1 o'clock to 3 o'clock, and that's time for you to go off and do some of those things on your Christmas list that need to be done. And then that next day, the 16th, the children will be singing a beautiful Christmas song with Diane Loyo. She's been working with them on that. And the following Sunday, the 23rd, they're going to recite some passage verses from Luke 2 that they've been working on. And so we have really been enjoying this Christmas season with the children. Today we're going to talk about the early church and how important the love and the serving of each other was in the early church. And we're going to compare it to our church today and see just how we are responding that same way to the love of God by the Holy Spirit in us to serve and love each other. So I invite all the children, kindergarten through grade 6, to join me.
Bet y'all thought I was going off to children's church. Israel had asked me if I would share about my Bible reading plan and my journey and put some humanity around the reality of our devotion, our commitment to being faithful followers of Jesus Christ. I'm an iPhone user. I'm an Apple guy. And about a year and a half ago, not this past summer, but summer before last, on a Facebook group, a friend of mine who I haven't seen in a few years says, hey, we're putting together a Facebook group, and we're just going to read the Bible in a year, and no phone calls, no meetings, but once in a while we'll just check in the group and you can ask questions. So I downloaded on my iPhone a free Bible. I'm real cheap. The only money I spend on apps are the cards that the kids give me for Father's Day and my birthday. But I downloaded the YOU version of the Bible. And it comes with a bunch of devotionals that you can choose. And I decided I was going to read Genesis through Revelation, just in what I call book order, from July 1st to July 1st. Well, the journey was, it really took about 14 months with some bumps and gaps along the way. But the YouVersion app, it sets it up, you open it, it reminds you to read. If you fall behind, it sends you a little email saying, hey, would you like a little catch up? We can just kind of forget about the last 2 weeks and you can pick up where you left off. But the reality was, it's about a commitment and about a place and a time. And I'm not very good like Pastor or about David in the Bible that says, early in the morning do I rise up to seek thee. I'm not a morning person. If you are around school during the week, you know that's not me. But I decided that for the most part, and I think Diana will prove it, is that I would go out after dinner and sit out in the front yard with the dogs, and I would read from my iPhone the assigned passage of Genesis through Revelations, and I worked my way through. I was going to do it again this July 1st, except I wanted to read it historical, from however the history works, because it's not the book order, but I got stuck, and I'm looking forward. I'm glad you guys said, hey, let's begin again on January 1st, so I'm looking forward to doing it. Diana gave me what she has done in the past, which is a printed Bible. It's reading the Bible all the way through the Bible in 1 year. You read Old Testament, New Testament, Psalms, and Proverbs every day, and you just follow day one, day two, day three. And then just one more comment. When I opened YOUVersion this morning, I discovered there's even 5-day Christmas readings. And if you wanted to read through the Christmas story in a month, or do something one day a week with your kids, there's lots of routines and structures out there that we can use to really delve into reading God's word and being faithful to him as we study this great revelation of faith and practice in our lives. So if you want to talk more about a techie way to read the Bible or read parts of the Bible, I'd be happy to do that. Thanks.
Sorry, Craig. This is supposed to be on my ear, and it was in my pocket. So my apologies. Thanks, Mike, for sharing that. I had asked Mike to just share his journey with reading the Bible in a year. We are encouraging people, we want to encourage all of you to just be in the Bible, to be in God's Word daily. And if you are up for the challenge of reading the whole Bible in a year, well, that would just be great. But if you feel like that's just too hard right now, you're too busy, it's just you've got a lot of other things on your plate, you work at a law office, you're reading, 30 books a day, you're busy, I get it. But you just want to do something a little smaller, just our whole goal is just that you would just be in the Bible, even if it's one verse a day, just chewing on God's Word, letting it feed your soul, seeing what God has to say to you, because it's valuable and it's important, and God wants to speak to us, and He wants to speak to you. So thanks, Mike, for sharing that. And also the reality is, you know what? If you try this, some of you will just read through it in a year, no problem. And there are some of you that have done that. But if you're like me, you might fall behind. You could fall behind for 3 months. I don't know. But and I've done that, and you can just catch up again. Or you just start where you left off, and you keep going. But we want you in the Bible. Let me pray for us one more time, and then we'll get into the Bible. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for this time together. And I pray your blessing on our people. Father, that you'd speak to us powerfully through your word. We want to walk with you and follow you. And we trust you, Lord. And we thank you for this just time to just reflect on the coming of Jesus and to sing the songs that we've sung this morning and to reflect on those powerful truths. And I pray that you would continue just to open our eyes and our hearts to what you have to say in John 1:14. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, if I asked you to pick one thing in history that you thought was absolutely the single most amazing event that took place in human history, what would it be? But you could only pick one event. Of all the amazing events in history, you only get to pick one was just the single most amazing event with the greatest impact, maybe. Well, I thought I would check on the internet, because it is the bastion of wisdom that it is, to see what people thought about the most amazing event that ever took place in human history. And I wrote down some of those ideas, and I found several lists, but one of the lists I found I will give to you in the order from least to the first. And it starts like this. The single most amazing event in human history was World War II, which was an amazing event, and it was, often called the largest and the deadliest war. World War I came in number 9 as the most significant, most amazing event in human history. Number 8 was the Renaissance. We have art, science, learning, the promotion of those things, beauty, all kinds of issues. Number 7 was the Black Death. The Black Plague is being the single most amazing event in human history. Number 6 was the signing of the Magna Carta, with its promotion of freedom and influence even on America. Number 5 was the establishment of the Roman Empire with democracy. I would say we certainly feel that impact today. Number 4 was the discovery of electricity. Well, that's a powerful one. Powerful. Some of you are carrying that in your pocket even. It's true. Number 3 was the invention of paper. Just ask the office or anyone employed by the office making lots of money. Paper is a pretty powerful thing. I mean, you have, because of the invention of paper, I didn't see anyone walk in with a 50-pound scroll made out of animal skin. Pretty amazing event in human history. Number 2 was the establishment of laws by Egyptians. This is just what it said. And number 1 was the birth of civilization in summer, and the year-round agricultural issues that took place because of that. That came in number 1. And there were lots of other lists, and one One particular article said the single most amazing event, most significant event in history was the Battle of Thermopylae. You know, recently was a really interesting movie portrayed about that with the 300 Spartans plus a few hundred other Greeks. They faced the Persian army of whatever, a million or 2 million, whatever, whether it was a million or 300,000 or 100,000 or 10,000, pretty amazing event, arguably. I mean, maybe you would speak a different language if things had turned out differently. Others have argued, well, no, maybe not that. Maybe the Gutenberg press. With that kind of modern technology to get information out quickly and produce it more rapidly. And you could start wars like that. You could write a Bible and give lots of people the Bible, something like that. Now, as Christians, you know, there's a, I would imagine those would not make our top list. As followers of Jesus, it wouldn't be there. There's some other things, very powerful, amazing events in human history that stand out to us, like creation itself by God. That's a standout for me, creation. The incarnation, God taking on flesh. The second person of the Trinity, the Son of God becoming man. The atoning, the sacrificial atonement of Jesus Christ on the cross. But if you only had to pick one, what would be the one you'd pick? Or how about the resurrection? The resurrection that we hope in because of the resurrection of Jesus. Or the glorification to come. All amazing events. And some theologians say that the single most amazing of all of the events is the incarnation. I'm just saying that some of them say that. The single most amazing event in human history is the of God taking on flesh. It is those four words. The Word became flesh. Think about it. God took on flesh. Fully God, fully man, totally unique, happens once, done, won't happen again. Duplicate that. God did that. The single most amazing event in history, dare I say, the most humbling event in human history, that God, the creator of everything, knowing everything, being everywhere at once, having intimate knowledge of all your thoughts right now simultaneously and the rest of the world and everything going on in the cosmos right now, every aspect to the smallest, finest detail, whatever that is, intimately knowing that, and he became flesh. He took on humanity and did not get rid of his deity, maintain being fully God simultaneously. This is absolutely profound. And it is profound. It is so profound that it dumbfounds the wise of our age. They think it's crazy. They think you're crazy and I'm crazy for believing that because it doesn't make sense to them. And you know what? I have a hard time wrapping my mind around that, don't you? It is the most amazing event. Human history. It is the most profound event in history. And it's profoundly significant for us and profoundly humble that God would do this, take on flesh. So it's amazing. Eternal, Son of God, always existed, becomes humanity. So if I could just take you to John chapter 1, I will take you through this very brief verse this morning. John chapter 1. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. 1:14. John has argued that in the beginning was the Word, and that the Word was with God, and the Word was God. There's eternality to the Word. The second person of the Trinity, the Son of God, has always existed. Always. And then it says in 14, there's this revelation of who the Word is. The Word takes on flesh. This is Jesus, Son of God. So it says this in verse 14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. But I want to stop there, because next week is about him dwelling among us. But this week is about the Word becoming flesh. These four words, it's so brief, I know. It's so profound what is in this, what's so tightly knit in this statement. And the Word became flesh. One of the first things I want you to see is just that word, Word. This is about, it's important that we understand a few things about these words here before we go on. The Word, and I've said it, the second person of the Trinity, the Son of God, he's eternal. The Word is eternal. He is not created. He is not created. And we live in a world that wants to say he's created. And let me just say, I'm going to say it over and over. He is not created. He has always been eternal. The Word has always been uncreated. He's the Word. The second thing I want you to look at is the fact that he became. When this eternal second person of the Trinity, eternal Word, became flesh, he did not get rid of his deity. He did not become less than God. Somehow in the midst of that, he doesn't utilize his every God ability, but he does not cease to be God. He is God forever. And so when he becomes, when he takes on humanity, he takes on flesh, he doesn't get rid of being God. He is the God-man. And that is profound. And that is immensely humbling. That God would humble himself like this? And then the other word is flesh. That he took on flesh. He became flesh. Doesn't get rid of his deity. Fully God, fully man. You know what? This word is used in some different ways in the Bible. And one of the ways that it's used is used in a negative sense. The word flesh can be fleshly desires, right? Fleshly, sinful desires, sinful passions. Sin. Flesh. But that's not the use here, and that's not the use in other places in the Bible. It has, you know, different meanings. And here, it has to do with him taking on humanity. The word took on humanity. And this is so profound and so important that you understand this, because Jesus did not take on our sin nature. You and I were born into sin, but not the Son of God. You and I were, not him. I mean, think about this. There are people that want to argue this all the time because they have a certain tug toward babies. And we all do. We all were a baby. We all were a baby one time. And you'll hear people say they're innocent. And you know what? I understand what you mean when we say that they're innocent. But there's a very profound way in which they are not. Because they inherit a sin nature. You and I inherit it. We're born into sin, the Bible says. We're born into sin. And so when we say, you know, they're innocent, I understand. Because, you know, it's sort of like the wrestling world, when people would boast about being a great wrestler, when he was born, he shot a single leg and took his dad down and choked him out. Or when, you know, it's like, you know, we have this image of a lack of innocence, meaning, well, babies came out of the womb like a Spartan with a sword and hacked off someone's head. You know, and like, So we don't, I know they're innocent of that. Like, I know they don't even know what that is. I can presume that they have no idea what that is, to kill or some sort of sin like that, that we have knowledge of. They have no knowledge of that. But see, their lack of being born innocent has nothing to do with what they've done, but rather what they've been born into, and that is they've inherited the sin of Adam. We've all inherited the sin of the first man, Adam. It's passed on, and we get it. And it's quite this, but Jesus, when he took on flesh, when he took on humanity, he did not take on the sin nature. And that is just so valuable and so important that we understand that, because he was perfect. Jesus is the perfect Lamb of God, spotless. He is the perfect sacrifice. But no mere man could be that sacrifice. It would be a tainted sacrifice, but Jesus is not. And so that's why it's important that we understand that when the Son of God took on flesh, when the Word became flesh, he did not take on our sin nature. So it's amazing. It's profound. You know, second, let me just tell you this, that there's a lot of significance to this amazing event in the Word becoming flesh. There's a lot of significance. One of them is this, that it's absolutely necessary for salvation itself. It is absolutely just necessary for salvation, because you know who's guilty in the universe? It's man. It's mankind. Adam's sin, his disobedience, it brought sin into the world. He did. And so it corrupts the whole thing, and it corrupts us. And so because of that, a man must pay the price. But a man cannot handle the burden of the wrath of God. That's amazing to me. It would take God to handle the wrath of God. And that's why you have the perfect one. You have the Son of God, fully man, and the only one able to take on the wrath of God to pay for sin. So a man has to pay the price, but the only man that could do it is Jesus. The other thing that's very significant about this whole issue of the Word becoming flesh is it's a test for Christianity. I don't know if you ever thought about that. It's actually a test. And you know, it has very practical implications for the world that you and I both live in, and the one that John lived in. You know, there's a couple of other letters written by John. Go later in your Bible, right toward the end, near the book of Revelation. In 1 John chapter 4, John gives this like scientific, like litmus test. This is like proof of whether or not these people are from God. So in John's day, there would be these people that they denied that Jesus came, that God came in the flesh, that the Christ came in the flesh. They denied that. They didn't believe that for whatever reason. Well, we have that's in our culture. That's in our world. There's people that don't believe that. They believe that's crazy. And so he says this is a test. So he said, "Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God." This was a test that he gave them, you know, they could use. So if they confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh, it's from God. Well, that's interesting. That's very, very interesting. Because I can think of a couple of religions in our culture right now that can affirm that, but they're not Christianity. Okay, so he goes on. He goes on to speak very harshly. So in 2 John, verse 7, it's one chapter long, it says this: "For many deceivers have gone out into the world, those who do not confess the coming of Jesus Christ in the flesh. Such a one," now here it comes, "is the deceiver and the antichrist." He calls them antichrist. They don't believe that Christ came in the flesh. It's a test. Now, wait a second. In a very practical way, what if you have a friend who calls himself a Christian, sort of? I know, I just, you know, in saying this, I know for some of you with your background and who you interact with and friends, I just want to be sensitive in how I'm saying this, but I want you to know the truth, the weightiness of this. See, just recently I read this lecture from, I think it was the president of Brigham Young University, he's a Mormon, to Harvard University. And I was reading very carefully through his lecture. And oh man, it sounds like Christianity at first. But there's some things that pop out and you're like, no, it's not. Dude, you are a sneaky guy. And then you have another one, and I was reading the Jehovah's Witness, the main website, the main, you know, like that represents the beliefs of Jehovah's Witness, and both these different religions. Well, if you were to ask, if you have a friend who's a Mormon, and you said, do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, that he came in the flesh? You know what they'd say? They would say yes. And you'd be like, wow, that's what John says. John says that's a pretty good test. But you know, it's amazing how crafty our enemy is. Satan is so crafty to get people to say something like that, because there's some deception. There's some major deception behind that. Because if you ask them this, well, do you believe that Jesus was created? Do you know what they would say? Absolutely, they would say yes. Well, that's a counterfeit Jesus. That's not an eternal son of, that's not God. Because in the John is assuming, and he says it very clearly, that the Son of God is eternal. That he's God. And God is eternal. And anything less than that is not God. It's just not. It's some man. And it's not God who can pay for sin. It's not God who can be a priest forever. It's not. It's just a man. But the same John who wrote the Gospel of John wrote those books. He's assuming an eternal word, not a created one. So it's very practical. This issue is very significant. It's a test of whether or not you have Christianity. Man, I'll tell you what, Satan is so crafty. Now let me just pause and say this. You know what? You don't have to be this expert reader and expert in every religion that exists out there and know how to work through all the difficult and painful nuances of all the words and concepts, difficult concepts. Dude, not everyone's called to do that. And maybe some of you are, and others of you are called to other kinds of things. And you just need to know? The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. God did that. And it's absolutely amazing. That's what you need to know. You need to know Jesus. John is making this argument. The Word became flesh. And it's absolutely profound. There is a lot tightly bound in those few words, and it is amazing, and we have an enemy who wants to corrupt that by inventing religions that deny it. Oh, it's so crazy. Oh, so confusing, too. Here, I want to move into some practical implications of the reality, the amazing reality that the Word became flesh. Not only is it amazing, but it is the most humbling, it is the most humble thing that we could ponder. You know what? And the Bible says that. In Philippians, I know for many of you here, this is not new. You've heard this over and over and over. And that, you know what? For a very small group of you, maybe this is the first time you've ever heard this. And this just sounds like, man, there's so many words, and the Word became flesh and eternal. And let me just point out the humility of Christ. Here is a practical implication of the Word becoming flesh. And Paul says this. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 4 through 8, many of you have read this over and over, but just hear it with fresh ears after pondering the Word became flesh and the humility of that, God taking on humanity, not our sin nature, but our humanity with all its vulnerable parts. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped or utilized, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. That humility starts with him coming and being fully God, the incarnation. That humility comes with him, with the Word becoming flesh. God would do that? That's amazing. Let's test our humility. You know, because I suppose that a lot of, you know, this the application for us, like humility and servitude, you know, I don't think it's difficult in the large event sense for us to gather together, and we should do it, and serve our city together. And we try to. We have things that we do. They're really cool. We do Serve Whittier. Really great. If you've never been a part of it, you've got to do that in the spring. You know, if our building was under construction, we'd be doing the cold weather shelter, or we would be serving our community, those in our city, and trying to love them. But you know, you want to know where humility and service is really tested? It's in the day-to-day, simple, mundane things. Because we can gather together and do, and you know, we can do bigger things if we work together. But you want to be a servant? Try it in the everyday stuff. Well, let's just start with job. You know, it's interesting to me, and in all my experience, and maybe you're in the same boat, but whenever you've ever been on a job interview, and that person says, "I'm sorry, I don't have what you're looking for, but you know what? But I like you. I think you seem pretty cool." They would use that word too, by the way. Seem pretty cool. Because when you're interviewing, you can say whatever you want, because they're not the ones trying to get the job. You are. I have like an entry-level position. It's sweeping. So what happens in your heart and in your mind when you're sitting across from that interview? Do you know who I am? You want me to sweep? You want me to sweep? I don't sweep. I've got ideas. I should work with you. I could run this thing. I mean, I don't know. You ever been in that situation? You don't, and they want you to sweep or throw out trash or move tables. I don't move tables. I'm the idea guy. Oh. Well, sorry, that's all we have right now. We got all kinds of ideas. We just need someone to move some tables. What about this? Now, you know, I understand that there's a time that, you know, maybe you got to make more money or whatever it is, and you got to work hard, but sometimes you just need a job. You just got to take that job and sweep or serve coffee or sell a widget, whatever. I mean, I don't know. Sometimes you just got to work a job, no matter how low you think it is, because you did something greater before. Or you were praised before, and now you're not going to be. You're not going to be noticed. People are going to throw things on the floor, and you're going to have to pick it up now. Get your hands dirty. Well, how about this? We all, you know, there's a lot of people with kids in here. What about those who are either parents or grandparents, and we're going to sporting events? There's a lot of us in here. Now, what happens when we are an expert in that particular field of sport? I mean, we did it for years. We're really, really good, whether it's tennis, baseball, basketball, football, on. Golf, I don't know. We're good. I mean, we competed D1. Now we're gonna go observe our child or grandchild being, you know, coached. Here's the test of humility. How hard is it for you to keep your mouth shut because you're such an expert? Because and not tell that coach what he needs to do to make this a winning team? Well, Mom, Dad, we're just trying to expose them to the sport. No, don't you want to win? I play D1. I'm good. I know what I'm talking about. We just want them to kind of like it. No, we don't want them to like it. We want them to win. That's crazy. How about at church? You want to get real practical with incarnation, with how we serve each other in the church? What are you willing to do when it comes to serving your local church? Are you willing to have ideas? Are you willing to pick up trash? Because we're looking for servants. Servants pick up trash. And you say, no, there's someone already paid to do that. Or people to move tables. Or print something. But I like to serve here. I've heard people say this before. This is really interesting. I'm saying I've heard other leaders talk about their people, not our people, because our people wouldn't do this. But I heard a leader say, you know, sometimes I'll have guys, they'll come and say, hey, yeah, you know, I want to serve here. And oh, they're like, be like, I want to teach. I want to go teach in youth or whatever. I'm a teacher. Oh, wow, man. You know what? We could use some more teachers. Would you be up for it? Could you help us? We just need to set up. Whoa. You want me to set up? Dude, I'm a teacher. I'm a good teacher. They need to hear what I have to say. Well, we've got a couple guys doing that right now. They're on a rotation, you know. Could you like set up chairs? You want me to serve? Yeah, like Jesus. We want you to serve like Jesus. Or how about this? What happens when we're listening to other people? Pastor John has said this a lot. When we're listening to each other and we're talking to someone else, what is in the back of our mind and in our hearts? Are we thinking of what we want to say? Pastor John has said that many times. Are we thinking, not what they're saying, blah, 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 blah. That's all we hear. We're thinking of what we want to say next. Wah, 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 wah. What I got to say is really important, so I'm getting ready to say that. Or are we thinking of them? I mean, are we more interested in what their thought? Are we more interested in not only what they're thinking, but are we more interested in their story or in them hearing our story? You should hear my story. It's so great. Or are we humble? I mean, to think about it, the Son of God became humanity. God did that? Humanity, us, with weakness? The God who made everything, who spoke the world into existence, took on humanity? Entered the world as a baby? You know, one of the great tests of our service and humility is how we would complain with one another. You ever have a complaint with your spouse? Or with a friend? Or with a coworker, or wherever. I mean, there's a million. Do you complain with humility? Do you ever assume, maybe I have a part in this too? Or no, everyone else is the issue, not me. Clearly not me. Because the test for humility is, you know what, I have a part too, let me tell you my part. Can we talk about this? Instead of, I'm perfect and you're messed up. Come see me when you're ready to talk about that. The Word became flesh, and it is amazing. It is profound. There's nothing like it. It'll test our humility. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your love for us, and pray you'd help us to walk with you in a way that's pleasing and humble. As we reflect on the Word becoming flesh, may it just be a sweet interaction with you, God, during the season. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to sing one song before communion here. I'd ask you all to please stand together. We'll sing the song.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. Were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing Lord, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing. I know it's true.
My thanks to Pastor Israel for opening God's Word, and we've been talking about what we're doing here for the last month or so, and I really appreciate Israel taking a rich, rich phrase and reminding us how important it is that we understand who Jesus is and what he did in taking on flesh for us. Listen to these words once again that Israel read. Each of you should look not only to your own interest, but also to the interest of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, can you say that Jesus is God? Always has been, was never created. Being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant and being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. This table that we gather around today is a communion table. We are saying by participating in this together that we believe that Jesus, who is the living God, took on flesh for us. And he came to be an obedient servant and to die on the cross to pay for your sins and mine. And we're saying, as we take these elements today, that our confidence is not in our religious pedigree. It's not in our promises. It's not in our performance. It's in what he did for us. We invite all of you who are followers of Jesus to say, I know that I belong to him. We invite you to share, to hold these elements, and then we'll take them together. That night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, this is my body, which is for you. As often as you eat it, remember me. We thank you, Lord, for this fresh reminder that Jesus poured himself out of heaven and took on flesh. What humility in this reminder. What humility that the eternal God did this for us. Jesus said, "This is my body, which is for you. As often as you eat it, remember me." And then Jesus took the cup and he called it a new covenant, a new promise in his blood. Thank you, Father, for this cup that's a reminder that you always keep your word. You promised that you would send the Messiah, a Savior. Over and over again, you said you would do that, and you did. We thank you, Father, that Jesus kept his word when he said he would sacrifice himself for us on that cross, and he did. And thank you for the promise that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. And we thank you, Father, for the promise that he'll come again. Jesus said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's say together, until he comes. Until he comes. We thank you, Father, that we can get, that we can lean on Jesus always, because he is so faithful to cleanse and forgive all who trust in him and in his blood to cleanse us. I pray this in his name. Amen. It's our custom every month after we take communion to give a benevolent offering to go to meet very special needs of people in our congregation and community. As you give now, give to the Lord. Would you stand with me, please? Before I close the service out, I'd like to call your attention to something that people standing at the doors will have for you this morning. A couple weeks ago, someone wrote in their bulletin, in the response form, please help me be able to share the gospel this Christmas with friends and family who don't know God. And so we've prepared something for you, and we've prepared something that for the next 2 weeks we'll be having Christmas programs with our school. And so we've prepared a very beautiful and lovely piece. It's just a two-page little devotional guide, and it's on the front of it. It says Christmas Table Talk. It says take time around the table or at bedtime to have meaningful conversations this Christmas season. Our church has prepared questions for everyone in your family. It will knit your hearts together around the one who came to show his amazing love. And so I'd like you to take one of these. If you can use it, you might even want to take one for a friend that you might, if they've got young ones in the home, there's a key at the top. There are questions for preschoolers, and there are questions for elementary age, questions for teens, and questions for us as adults. And it's a really neat thing to hear the family talk with questions designed for their age level and for you parents or grandparents to enter into a conversation with them. 6 days of devotions. You can start right away. There's a question in here. This is a powerful one. She'll give birth to a son, and you're to give him the name Jesus, because he'll save his people from their sins. Adults, the question for you is, how do we honor the name of Jesus in our home? Get one from the people at the door, and I trust that you'll use it. Make it a good, good use. Some profound things can happen at bedtime or around the table. Father, dismiss us now with the peace and joy that comes from knowing the one who is the eternal God, who came for us. We thank you in his name. Amen.